Good evening. This is the regular May meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, and we'll begin with the call of the roll.
Nancy Masterton.
Here.
Jane Amorow.
Here.
Penelope Carson. Lester Jordan.
Here.
William Jordan.
Yeah.
Frank Latore.
Here.
Douglas Tinsman.
Here.
Are there any reports or correspondence that any of the council members would like to report on? Mike?
Not being a council member, I did have one quick announcement. The Portland Water District, we've had discussions with towards the end of last week regarding an open house at the new treatment plant. And after looking at a number of possible dates, it appears that Saturday, June 4th, would be the most appropriate date available, perhaps with a ceremony at 10:30 with the open house from 10 to noon for all citizens who wish to tour the plant. And, at that time, there'll also be a number of state officials invited, and would hope that most of the council might be able to be in attendance.
Good. We'll plan on that date. Any other? Yes. Councilor Latour.
Yes. This really doesn't fall under report or correspondence, but it's just I wanted to let some people know that may be watching, maybe here tonight, in terms of dam repair. It was talked about that we may have had on tonight's agenda repairing a certain dam that we need to repair in town in order to restore one of the ponds. And I just wanted to let people know that due to a time problem where everything has to be in by Wednesday at noon before it can be on the agenda, that it will be on the June agenda rather than on this evening's agenda for anyone who is waiting for that specific item tonight. It will not be taken up tonight, but it will be taken up in June as to whether or not to take that money out of the Greenbelt monies that we have in order to repair a dam. So I just wanted to let people at home and here know that.
Thank you. Any further reports? Then we will proceed to the minutes of April 6, 1988 and April 11, 1988.
Madam Chairman.
Councilor Amorow.
I move the minutes be accepted as written, the minutes of the April 6th and April 11th meeting.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. We'll begin with item number 78, to consider a resolution proclaiming May 1988 as Child Abuse and Neglect Prevention Month within the town of Cape Elizabeth. And we have here a resolution from the Cape Elizabeth Town Council on Child Abuse and Neglect Prevention Month. Whereas child abuse is a continuing problem in our society and in Southern Maine, and whereas every child is entitled to be loved, cared for, and nurtured, and whereas the prevention of child abuse and neglect involves the education of our young people, both before and after they become parents, and whereas the Cumberland County Child Abuse and Neglect Council has active Cape Elizabeth participants and hopes to involve the total community in support for programs which foster child abuse prevention now. Therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council in Town Council assembled, do hereby proclaim May 1988 as Child Abuse and Neglect Prevention Month within the town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine. Dated this ninth day of May, 1988, at Cape Elizabeth, Maine, Nancy N. Masterton, Chair, Lester E. Jordan, Frank P. Latore, Douglas A. Tinsman, Penelope P. Carson, William H. Jordan, and Jane A. Amorow. And I see in the audience Bill Byers.
Council, thank you, Mike,
very much. We very appreciate it.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Thank you.
Item number 79, to consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding boat repair facilities and take any necessary action. And Doug, Councillor Tinsman, I understand that you're going to report.
Well, just...
Just a moment before you do. Councillor Jordan.
I hate to do this, but I assume I should abstain from any action on this item.
Thank you. Councillor Jordan.
The Jordan boys are going to have to abstain from this action, from this item here.
Do we have the consensus of the council that both councillors, Jordan, may abstain on the discussion and the vote on this item?
Yes.
Okay. Then we will proceed with Councillor Tinsman, a member of the Ordinance Committee.
Just a brief summary of our work. We met last. Councillor Carson and I represented the Council of the Ordinance Committee and discussed the Planning Board's recommendation for the boat building facility in the RA zone. And the recommendation of the Planning Board seemed to be a sound recommendation, with the exception of three provisions that we debated at fairly good length and discussed with the town attorney and town manager, who were also in attendance. It was a feeling of the Ordinance Committee that the lot size of 20 acres as proposed by the Planning Board seemed to be a little excessive, and that in discussing and trying to size out a reasonable size lot, we came up with what we thought was reasonable, and that was 200,000 square feet, which is just a little bit shy of 5 acres. Now, in doing so, we tried to anticipate how many lots could be utilized with a 200,000 square foot requirement as opposed to the almost 20 acres. And there were approximately 20 lots with 20 acres or more, which would be allowed in approximately 96 of the 5 acre lots or the 200,000 square foot. So we felt fairly comfortable with that reduction. The second point that we altered a little bit was the setback requirements as set forth by the Planning Board. With a 200-foot setback on all sides, it wouldn't leave much of a building in a 200,000 square foot lot. We felt that 150 feet would properly shield abutters and offered a good compromise. The third provision that we wanted to try to stress in this new ordinance was that no boat shall be built or repaired at such facility to be transported over public roads which will endanger the safety of the public or require the moving of utility lines. And I think that was more of an attempt to make a statement that just be careful that you don't get carried away with your boat building operations and build a vessel that's just too large to transport safely over the roads. Certainly, if you had direct access to the water, it wouldn't be a problem, but it doesn't address the oversized loads, just the bulk and the size that could come out of a shop. Anyway, those are the only alterations that we've made, and we'd like to hear if there are any comments.
Councilor Amaro.
I just would like to ask Councilor Tinsman if this language that you're recommending tonight makes it clear that a person who owns a boat and wants to keep it in their yard and work on it during any time of the year will be able to do so.
Well, we're not sure that this language provides for that, but there is language in other parts of our ordinance that do allow the working on your own boat in your own yard type.
So this
is prohibited? No, this is for the employment of up to 4 persons engaged on a continuous basis in a boat building operation. And we felt fairly confident that that scenario that you brought forward is okay and should be.
With that, then, I'd like to move that item 79 be sent to public hearing be set for public hearing at our June 13th meeting.
Second.
Before we take a vote on this, I have a question, Doug, on your change, your third change about the transporting over the roads. Who is going to determine whether a boat that is being built or fixed is too large to be transported, and at what point is that going to be determined? Before it gets worked on, after it gets worked on, during the transporting? It's pretty vague.
Okay, that's a good question. I'm not sure how that would break down into, you know, when the public is notified or when the chief of police is notified. But usually the state requires a permit for oversized loads. And this is generally issued by either the state police through coordination with a local chief of police. And I would assume if a vessel is that large, then it would certainly be brought to everyone's attention at that point. The attempt for putting it within the ordinance is to make the statement known to people running the shop that this requirement does exist, just to put them on notice. That's all.
Mike?
You should also mention that site plan review by the planning board is required under this proposal, and that would certainly be an issue that would come forward during that process.
I'm just thinking about the situation where the boat builder accepts a job of a large boat. Nobody knows anything about it. The boat gets built, and then it is too big to be safely transported on a Cape Road. Then what?
I don't know. I don't enforce them. I just
it's just right there.
Any other questions or comments? Then the motion has been made and seconded to post this to public hearing at our next regular council meeting in June. All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous of those voting. One thing that we should go back and correct is that we didn't take a vote on the resolution that I hope that we will pass regarding child abuse and neglect. All those, is there a motion to do so?
Second.
Second. All those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Okay. Item number 80. To consider a report from the town manager regarding the Michael Carson National Wildlife Refuge and take any necessary action. Michael?
Yes, earlier this year, the town council had before it a proposal for the Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge, or more specifically the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, to purchase a portion of the Spurlink Marsh adjacent to the Poor Farm. At that time, the town council did not agree with the proposal to sell the land in fee simple, and instead asked the town manager to negotiate a conservation easement with the United States Department of Fish and Wildlife. Subsequent to that vote, had a number of meetings with Steve Dyer of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Realty Division, as well as with Andrew French, who is the manager from Wells of this division of the Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge. In the negotiations, we attempted to address the issues that had come up at the public hearing that was held on this subject, as well as some of the objections that the town council members had. In mid-March, I circulated a draft to the town council, and we have before you a proposal tonight that carries forward, I believe, the outline of what you asked for in an agreement. I think specifically, maybe I should touch on a few of the points. First of all, there is the issue of what the compensation would be for the easement. The appraisers at the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service did determine that the conservation easement had a value of $37,600. In addition, in the conservation easement, there was an issue involving vegetation and whether or not the picking of berries and other things would be allowed. The provision that is in this proposal reads, no vegetation shall be disturbed except the harvesting of wild berries, heather, wildflower, etc. is permitted. Vegetation may also be disturbed to perform biologically sound fish and game management activities or as needed for public safety. In other words, the harvesting of berries, heather, wildlife, wildflowers is permitted. There is a provision also here that addresses concerns that the roadway should ever be widened. This allows extension of 75 feet on either side of the road, on either side of any road, quite a considerable distance. In addition, there was a concern that perhaps motorboats might not be allowed. There's a new provision here that the use of motor vehicles, and then in addition, excluding boats powered by motor or aircraft, except in an emergency or when necessary to accomplish the purpose of this grant or the reserve rights of the grantor, are specifically prohibited. There, in addition, a new paragraph, the grantee hereby agrees that hunting and fishing will continue to be permitted in accordance with state and federal regulations. Steve Dyer and Mr. French are here. You might ask them what that provision is relating to federal regulations. There was also a concern about when would we close it down if there was a problem to do with public health. There was some bacteria or some sort of infection that could be taken out of the marsh. And there's a provision here that the grantor may close the land to hunting and fishing at any time without notice of public health and safety reasons. I've tried as much as possible, I think, to carry out the intent of what you asked for. You know, perhaps have missed the mark somewhat. I don't believe that we have, but I do offer it for your consideration.
Is Mr. Dyer here? Do you have a presentation that you would like to make?
I'm just here to answer questions.
Or to answer questions. Are there any questions? Councillor Lester Jordan.
Yes, I have two or three questions or comments. I guess the first one is a comment. I feel that $238 per acre offer is an awfully low offer for, especially in light of what land is going for in the town of Cape Elizabeth. I realize that this is wetlands and so forth, but to me that's a very low figure for 158 acres. Second of all, on about the second page or so, the vendors agree that they have full right, power, and authority to convey, etc. I don't quite understand how we have full right when I've heard a lot of people claim that they own a lot of that land, and I don't believe all that land that we're trying to sell belongs to the town of Cape Elizabeth, so I'm wondering how we're going to clear that mess up. Maybe there is a question for you. Number three, many citizens wanted to hold the bridge approaches, or the old bridge approaches. Many of the citizens wanted the old bridge approaches to be left so that the citizens and their children could enjoy fishing in that area. As I understand it, the state was agreeable to these concerns, but I also understand that the Rachel Carson Wildlife Group fought hard to remove this enjoyment in their negotiations with the state when the state wanted to build the new bridge. And I think it's a crying shame that we couldn't have an area like that left for kids or even adults to do some fishing. So I guess what I'm trying to say is I'm skeptical of what we might be left with in some of this agreement. And the last question I have, I do like a lot of the changes that were made before this final draft, so to speak, got to us, but I'm still a little skeptical on number four here and about the pages aren't numbered, so. No vegetation shall be disturbed except the harvesting of wild berries, heather, wildflowers, etc. is permitted. Now, it doesn't say, but how about harvested commercially? Are we going to be able to harvest those things commercially, or is that just harvested, period? And I guess that's the real question.
I'll defer to Andy, because Andy's the manager, and he would be able to answer that. I can answer your name. Your questions concerning value and the closing the titles and that sort of thing. But from a management standpoint, any of this area.
Regarding to question number three, the bridge approaches, and you indicated that Rachel Carson, National Wildlife Refuge, fought hard to have the bridge approaches removed. One of the reasons the bridge approaches were going to be removed, it was part of the mitigation that the state agreed to. Trying to lessen the impact on that particular wetland, as well as they did mitigation on some other wetlands. I'm also not sure, but on an aside, I'm not sure what kind of what type of liability would be there if that type of structure were allowed to remain, and if somebody got hurt. I'm not really sure on that, but one of the reasons it was decided that they would be removed was as mitigation, trying to lessen the impact in the area. As far as question number four, regarding the harvesting of wild berries, heather, wildflowers, etc., the intent, my understanding, the intent is it's for personal consumption, so that pretty much it's not.
Yeah, it doesn't. It was commercial was deliberately left out. Prohibition, so it could be either.
Also, it could be either. Okay.
It's not expressly prohibited.
Right.
Because harvesting is allowed, so that would cover.
Okay. What I was going to say is generally on National Wildlife Refuges, we do have commercial ventures, and those are regulated by permit. But if this does provide for that, then that's what would be allowed. I didn't have a problem from a management fish and wildlife management standpoint. Allowing the harvesting of vegetation, flowers, et cetera, because what we were hoping to do with this parcel of land primarily was to enhance the area for wildlife production during the breeding season. So if some of these things were removed, it's not going to have a significant impact on the resource. Kind of weighing out the different public interests that there are in the property. Did I answer your question?
Somewhat, yes. Good enough.
Okay, well, if you want more clarification, I...
No, the only other question that really hasn't been answered is that comment that I made on, I didn't feel that $238 an acre is sufficient.
Okay, that's Steve was going to respond to your first and second question.
Okay. And the other one was
title.
How
okay.
We can.
Let's take that one first. That's usually not as critical. It's my understanding, I've been in contact with the title company that ran the title for this. Title to this piece of property comes down through the Thomas Jordan will. I think we've kind of talked about this over and over again, and I don't think, from my understanding in dealing with the title company, it's a question of whether or not the title came to the town. The question comes as to whether or not the town has the right or the authority to convey the title, to convey the property under the restrictions that was as outlined under the Jordan will, because it said that the land was to be held in trust and in fee for the poor. I can't think of the exact verbiage that it said, but that was the issue. That's why, if you remember.
Well, that isn't my issue. That's just a small part of the marsh. You're taking 158 acres, and there's quite a few people along that area that feel that they own property right to the river. And maybe they haven't paid taxes over the years for it, but nobody ever sent them a tax bill either. And the people in their deeds feel they own that land to the river, and yet we're trying to sell their land, and I'm wondering how that's going to be resolved or something when it says that we can...
All I can tell...
We as a vendor agree that we have full right, and I don't feel that we have full right.
Well, that's fine, okay? All I can tell you is that we've had title run on it, and the title says the Jordan will. The will says that it goes to the town of Cape Elizabeth.
If that's that one piece, I'm talking about the
Well, opposite. I've shown the map to the title company of the land that has been put before the council, and the title company has told me that they would be willing to give us a title policy on this if we can, if we come to an agreement. That's why we hire title companies, to do that. And if they're selling, if they say that they're willing to certify, we take their word for it. We're not in their professional title abstracting business.
So the people that claim that they own this, they've got to spend their hard-earned money to prove that they own it and fight you. Is that this?
They're not going to fight us.
Going to fight the town of Cape Elizabeth?
No, they're not going to fight the town of Cape Elizabeth. If somebody comes forth and puts...
Who are they going to fight?
They're gonna go through the title company. They'll come to us and we will forward the information to the title company. If they come to the town of Cape Elizabeth, they're gonna say, look, the federal government bought this conservation easement or whatever. They said that they had certified title to it, that they could purchase it from the town, and then we're gonna go to the title company and say, hey, why? That's the way title works. There's a problem with a lot of titles in the state of Maine when you get into marshes. As the value for marshland as a resource to people dropped, in other words, there was not much use for it. Title in the latter part of the 1800s and that, when they stopped haying the fields and things like that, and it wasn't as productive, title just disappeared. The descriptions of the marshlands just, in a lot of instances in the state of Maine, disappeared from the chain of title. It's very difficult to trace down. And then with the heirs and everything else, and the descriptions being as they are in a lot of deeds up here. It's difficult to trace out. But when we hire a title company to do an abstract for us, and if they tell us that the landowners have the right to convey, we do. We take their word for it. Now, does that, probably doesn't satisfy you, but...
You're right, but
I can't do anything else, you know?
You're not gonna convince me no matter how long it's been.
I know that.
The other thing, can you give me any, satisfaction on why you're only giving us $238 an acre?
We're not buying the property in fee, okay? Purchasing a conservation easement is different than buying the full bundle of rights, okay? When we appraise a property, and if a landowner wants to retain certain rights, such as what we have here, where we try to work out some sort of workable agreement where the town can do the things that they'd want to see happen with the land, and we can also use the land for wildlife production and that. These things have a value. You sell something, that has a value. You retain something, that has a value. And to be quite honest with you, that's the difference. If you sell a thing outright, it's worth more. You retain certain rights to do some things with the property, that's worth something too. And our appraiser determined that that's what the value was.
So all the questions I have.
Councilor Torrey.
Just to follow up on that, what other towns have done this sort of thing? Is there anything else on record that we can compare this to? Because obviously you can see from our end, the 238 could be just a shot in the dark. You know, 500 an acre, 238 an acre. You know, we'll need some kind of a more justification, I think, in terms of maybe other deals that have happened either in the state of Maine or in New England or, you know, some comparables, because this number is just clearly out of the blue for us.
Yeah, I can't really give you an example of that. I mean, we've purchased conservation easements, but generally, it's like 50% of what you would normally pay for fee, somewhere within that range. They vary. The language differs. The values are... It depends on the property as a whole. It depends on the language that's in the conservation easement, how restrictive you make it. The more restrictive you make it, in other words, the more you are willing to give up, the more the value is worth in the terms of selling. As far as in terms of towns recently, I can't think of one that we've actually purchased.
How do you rate this in terms of restrictiveness then, on a 1 to 10? Is it very? It doesn't seem.
It's a compromise.
It seems like we're giving much of the rights up.
I know you're not. I mean, if I say 5, somebody says that's not enough. You know, I mean, I'd say it's somewhere in the middle, yeah. in my mind, because I draft a lot of these up, mm-hmm. and I know how restrictive we can make it, and I'd say it's somewhere down the middle. When we first went in to talk to Mike, and before we even walked to the door, I had already revised the language. The more I talked to Mike, about after the meeting that took place here, I realized that some of the things that we normally would put into a conservation easement didn't really even apply. But it was kind of like, I don't want to use the term menu, but you have certain things that you put in, and then people counter with that, and then you kind of work the language out and you try to find a compromise. Some of them lean more restricted towards the federal government, so that we get more, you get less, so therefore you get more money. Mm-hmm. I can't pin it down any more exact than that. I'm not trying to be evasive.
Okay. Then the only other question I have is regarding that, for public health and safety reasons, that you can close the land to hunting and fishing. Is there any kind of a further explanation of that, or?
You can close the land, not us.
We can close the land.
Yeah.
Okay.
We gave that. We felt as though you should have the right, it's your land, to determine what is a public health and safety. If you tell it's a hazard to the public, we're not going to argue with you. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. We figured, who better than you to make that decision?
And the only other thing is, when Councilor Jordan raised about commercial harvesting, is there any commercial harvesting going on there now?
Yes.
Is it in any way monitored or permitted or et cetera, such that the commercial harvesting doesn't in effect devastate or over-harvest the area? Or is there any element of control on how much can be harvested?
Most of the commercial harvesting that is going on is heather for resale. It's very limited. Otherwise, some berries. Someone may put, a card table out on their front lawn type thing. But it's not major at this point.
And the more heather you harvest, the more prolific the plant is.
Mm. It's just, they say that there's certain times when they restrict it, and probably rightfully so. So it doesn't get overly exploited. We might need to look at that at some point. But those are my questions, Madam Chairman. Thank you.
Any other questions, Councilor Tinsman?
I again want to follow up on this appraisal. I just, my own. Did you have a professional appraiser do the value?
We have professional appraisers on staff. They are, the person that did this appraisal is a member of the Appraisal Institute.
Okay, so it was a professional?
Yes,
even
it was.
Even though it was done in-house?
Yes.
Okay, the questions that I have, number 3, where it says no buildings or structures shall be built of any kind. Does that apply to duck blinds? Because I know we had some duck hunters in here, and I'm not sure.
That's
if
a good question.
To build them now.
I'll defer to Andy on that one, because that is considered a structure. You're right. That's a good point.
You read number 3, and I guess somewhat of an interpretation. You start off on 3, and is a duck blind a building, or is it something that provides access for the public and fish and wildlife management? Waterfowl hunting is a form of wildlife management. It does provide access for the public to perform wildlife management. So I that's something that that people hire lawyers to work on. As far as putting some duck blinds out there, it kind of gets back to the issue that was raised with heather. We have some gray areas here. How much vegetation can you harvest before you're compromising why you set it aside? How many duck blinds could we allow to be put out there before it starts to create another type of type of a problem. I think that as it is right now, where the language is right now, you folks kind of hold the control over how many duck blinds get put out there, because this is one of the this is an agreement that we're entering into, but this is something also that you're reserving in a way.
Okay, I agree that this is one of the items that lawyers tend to make a little bit of money on, and I'd like to see that inserted so that it doesn't become a gray area.
Mm-hmm.
I know it was a concern at the public hearing, and I'd like if the rest of the council sees fit to have that inserted. Another question I have.
Excuse me, I just had a question. You said you want it inserted. Do you feel that there should be in number three, should it address what type of a density would be acceptable and size? And because if you all of a sudden say you can have duck blinds out there, there are I've seen all kinds, and I've seen a lot in a small area. You know, do you feel that there should be an upper limit of duck blinds?
Well, I wouldn't oppose any language that would somehow regulate that, whether they be torn down immediately after the season or not. I'm not sure you're going to get 100 duck blinds in a small area. So, there aren't that many there now.
Okay, would you be agreeable to, because it should be addressed. I can see this from experience at other places, a temporary duck blind that would be removed at the close of the waterfall season. Would that be agreeable?
I have no problem with that. I don't know. I don't build duck blinds, so I don't know what the procedure is. I would think that would be a good idea. Another question I have is within the conservation easement. I mean, we're allowing you to go over and take a strong management position of our land. I mean, we're not selling you the land; we're just selling you the management tool in which to do the 11 provisions within this easement. I feel there ought to be at some point, maybe a number 12, there would be a reversion clause, which, again, I'm not an attorney, but it would seem to me that a reversion clause would say if the Rachel Carson Wildlife Management Team does not manage in such a way consistent with the easement, that it should revert back to the town. In other words, we're giving you the right to do this. We expect, in addition to the monies, that you do this. I mean, you're asking for all the things to be consistent with your management. I think we have a right to ask it be consistent with the intent. And I'm not sure how that language would work itself out. And I didn't think of this earlier. I would have asked for it earlier. But and then perhaps through some sort of annual report from the Rachel Carson group to the town manager, this would document the history of your management and just the ongoing things. I think it would be a good idea also to advise the town what you're doing, and perhaps we could enhance it with our own management tools. I mean, is this uncommon? Is it a good idea? Or
I haven't had any experience where I've entered into a formal agreement where I would be required to submit an annual report to a particular community. You know, if that's my primary interest is acquiring necessary interest in the parcel of land so that I can perform fish and wildlife management as well as provide it with the same protection a National Wildlife Refuge gets, because it would be part of Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge. It is our policy to coordinate and cooperate with local communities, as I've stated in previous meetings. And, you know, when we would be doing something in the area, we would notify the community. That may be three or four times a year. It might be once a year. It might be once every 2 years. It depends on what type of program we enter into and how often we have to engage in some type of management activity. But I can't overemphasize that anytime there is a question, you can contact our office. If this is something that that you want to make part of the agreement, this is something that, you know, that Steve would put down, and we would have to talk it over down in Boston. Kind of on an aside, I have a lot of different reports I have to do. And anybody that comes in after me, we have monthlies and quarterlies and annuals. And I would prefer to have more of a professional relationship where we routinely kept in touch with the community rather than sending in a report. Just the sake of getting in a report, we would keep you apprised of our management activities. I would prefer to have something like that we keep you apprised of our activities, which would make our contacts more appropriate and more timely. Would that be agreeable to yourself?
Well, I'm not sure what the will of the rest of the council is, but I think it's important to us where it's such a large piece of the cake. It's a small percentage of your overall management, mm-hmm. but it's still a very important piece of the cake. And whether it be a separate report or part of a total report that outlines what's been done in Cape Elizabeth, I think it would be an orderly process to determine what sort of progress has been made, and also let you know that we do still exist after the agreement signed. But the rest of the council will, if they decide to comment on that. Would the bridge embankments be additional consideration, or are they gone? The embankments that Councilor Jordan spoke about earlier, can they be salvaged? Can we add them as additional consideration? Because I, too, am very, very much in favor of those embankments staying, at least on the Cape side.
Well, as I said, the bridge embankments, that's really entirely separate from this approximately 160 acres, and that was an agreement that DOT made with the Army Corps of Engineers and the Environmental Protection Agency during the review process. That was coordinated out of our Concord office enhancement in Concord, New Hampshire office. And that would be, if they were not to perform that would be not respecting or be inconsistent with the conditions for which the project was approved. Fishing activities can be provided for in other ways that are a little less intrusive than a bridge abutment.
Okay, but as I understand the situation, it was the Rachel Pass and Wildlife Management Team which objected to that provision that they be left.
Yeah,
if you withdrew your objection, then I'm sure it would not be inconsistent with the policy that they could allow.
I was the refuge manager at that time. In fact, that was my first contact with Cape Elizabeth, was that one right after I transferred here. And as I recall, and I'd have to pull out that file, I can recall just about everything I write and say, and I don't recall ever writing or saying that was part of mitigation. Now, I do recall writing up, I do recall identifying mitigation sites. There were not any in the immediate vicinity. There were some down in the Wells area. Now, I recall writing all of that. The removal of the bridge abutments, I believe, is just a procedure they will go through, both the Corps, EPA, and our enhancement section of the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, just routine. Rather than leaving a bunch of abutments, you know, upstream and downstream, they routinely started to remove them as a part of mitigation, lessening the impact on that particular wetland, which is the case up here. I don't have anything that I can withdraw to answer your question myself.
Okay. Then would it be fair to assume that you would not support the Cape's position if it be the Cape's position to leave that embankment there? Would you support our position in a?
Well, I can't support your position. You can request. You probably should start with the Corps if you want to make that request, and that would filter down. But I'm not in a position where I can support the Cape and have myself going against EPA, Corps, and Fish and Wildlife Service policy. I'm not in that position. I say I can't. They'd probably say he doesn't count. And that would be the end of it, to be honest with you. Because that's not within the scope of my responsibilities.
Then you would not object if we asked for that?
It's not my property, and I have nothing to do with it.
Michael?
The Maine Department of Transportation Location and Environment Division was involved in long, very long, and extensive negotiations with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, with EPA, and with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, separate and apart from the local activities of the refuse, the Rachel Carson Wildlife Refuge. Part of the agreement was that in exchange for filling in so many net acres of wetlands, that so many net acres would be reclaimed, part on that immediate site and part elsewhere. Part of the gain on the immediate site was by the removal of the old bridge abutments. They were adamant at the time that they had to be removed. At this point, the bridge, according to information I heard last night while waiting for an ice cream and ran into the MDOT gentleman, the bridge is due to be open in the next 2 to 3 weeks, and the entire project is due to be done in 5 weeks, including the old cleanup. And I would just be very, very surprised if all those agencies did a complete about-face. They were extremely adamant before. In fact, negotiations took approximately a year on that subject.
And that was without the Rachel Carson group involving themselves?
Without this division of U.S. Fish and Wildlife.
I'd like to provide just one point of clarification. Rachel Carson National Wildlife Refuge would have never been involved in that project had there not been the refuge land involved. That's what we have, a division of, it used to be called Ecological Services, now they call themselves Habitat Enhancement. But that's why we have that division. They coordinate very closely with the Corps and the EPA, and it is policy to, first priority is to do your mitigation on site, in the same watershed. And there wasn't the opportunity to do it there, so they started to look elsewhere. And that's how I got involved in the second part of it, down in Wells. I identified some mitigation sites, working with DOT, trying to move things along on that.
Councilor William Jordan.
Thank you. I have a couple of three things here that I would like to follow up on. And number one, I don't agree with your title people as far as the Jordan Will goes as owning the land. I think I can produce you with another deed that in a section of that marsh that has ownership to it, and I think it borders one parcel that you already have. And also there's a book in Cape Elizabeth that at one time there was a Cape Elizabeth Diking Company on that marsh and run that marsh, and it has the individual owners that owned parcels at that time. And I don't know whether you people are aware of it or not, but I think it would have been something interesting for you people to look at. And the next is, I agree with Councilor Tinsman that possibility of the town should have a way out. That's the way I just jotted down, a way out if we don't agree in the way you're managing that marsh. If you're not doing anything, then maybe we should find out why. And if you are, then I feel that we should have a year-end report of your activities down there. And don't seem so that would be too much to give the town once a year of any of your activities down there. Now, is that a possibility or isn't it? I think we should be in contact once a year, one way or the other.
Well, first of all, there's a clause in here that says anything that's done on the property, it's not number nine.
Yeah.
Says that the grantor and grantee, the successors and assigns, agree that they will notify the appropriate party in writing of any proposed excavation or construction on the said conservation easement. We could modify that to include the type of management activities or something along those lines. As far as a year-end report, I don't want to totally speak for Andy on this, but I can tell you that there's a lot of people that we have to report to, and we don't mind working with the town. We could run this by Andy's supervisor back in the regional office and that, but to prepare a lengthy report for the town of Cape Elizabeth, I don't think they'd want to do that.
See, just to, you know, I'm not opposed to doing a report, an annual report. That's something we have to check with the regional office, because, you know, if I agree to it and Steve agrees to it and it ends up as a condition of the conservation easement, then we're agreeing that whoever comes in here for now till eternity is going to provide that report. I just, when I responded to Mr. Tinsman, you see, I may be quite active up here several times in one year, and because of the type of management we do, we might not be doing anything up here for a whole year or 2 years, depending upon what we engage in, other than coming up and doing routine wildlife census work, law enforcement, things like that. If that's the type of report that you'd like to get at the end of the year, I myself, as a manager, don't really have a problem with it, but that's something that we'd have to check with the regional office. I would rather have it a part of the conservation easement where it's written right in here that we coordinate closely with the town of Cape Elizabeth, letting the town of Cape Elizabeth know what we are doing as we go along. If I'm going to come up and, rather than coming up and say doing wildlife census work or law enforcement, if we're going to come up and do some management, I could notify in writing or telephone call, whatever, or both, whatever's easier.
If I may, I didn't read number nine as you interpreted it to me. I was interested if you put any duck houses out there, or any nesting areas and things like that during that year. I didn't read number nine as if that's what you was going to do.
I do plan to put in some artificial nest structures, of which I would notify the town of Cape Elizabeth, and if it doesn't present a problem, I'd notify them how many and roughly where I'd be putting them, and but I would do that prior to doing any activity.
Okay, all right. I didn't understand it that way, and if you're going to do that every time you do something down there, that's satisfactory to me. I was just wondering what the activities would be in the years to come.
Some kind of half the battle is protecting these areas, and then that's not only acquiring the land and protecting it, but providing, you know, adequate amount of law enforcement. I don't see any real problem up here, but the second half of conservation is actually managing areas. You know, there's fewer and fewer areas around that are left intact, and so we need to get as much out of these limited resources, especially in the coastal area, as we can. That's why this particular marsh is very important to us.
Okay. Number four, about the vegetation. As I read that, nobody could go out there and cut hay enough to remodel the blind. Is that correct? Did you classify that as vegetation? They got to take it from off the premises out there to fix a blind? They can't do it there.
Well, I was just going to say, my experience with blinds, I mean, there's plenty of stuff that's out there during the fall that's that's dead, you could say, you could insert that in there. You know, during the fall, that's the end of the growing season, and if somebody needs to put some type of vegetation in a blind, then they could take and use dead vegetation. The intent is to protect the vegetation during the growing season.
That's your intent, just during the growing season and after the season. It doesn't say that, and I know people that's how they remodel a blind and what have you.
Again,
and as long as somebody don't come along and say, hey, you can't do that, number four says, no, I don't want to get into that.
Okay, the other thing is, it says vegetation may be disturbed or perform biologically to sound fish and wildlife game management.
Thank
and
you.
Similar to three, the second part of three. You know, you could sit there and argue back and forth. You know, it's very difficult to put everything down black and white. As far as coming in and removing vegetation to fix a blind, that isn't a problem. As far as coming in and putting up a duck blind or two or three or whatever's appropriate for the area, that's not a problem. You know, I'd sure hate to see if it's written in there that they're temporary blinds and they're going to be removed, then I think that you wouldn't have a problem with seeing 10 or 12 blinds dotted all over that marsh. I don't think anybody really like to see that. So I think both three and four, the two things that came up, blinds and cutting vegetation for blinds, I'm not going to be down there, nor do I think anybody coming in after me or that works at the refuge causing a problem. It's not the intent, but if this can be reworded, I suppose, to provide for that. As I said, we could interject the word dead.
Well, I think it should be reworked a little bit. And besides, there's blinds going yearly, as you might say, and you have to remove them every year. I don't think that would go over very good with the hunters, because they like to have a structure that by their pond there all year round, and so the birds are used to what is there, then you go plump a new one down there, and it takes a little while for them to get used to it. And there's some that have been there for years, and I mean years and years, and in the same spot, and all they are is on those straddles, and they've cleaned out, and you've seen them, and there's one that's been in the family for a good number of years. Okay.
We have, Mr. Jordan?
Yes.
We have several other divisions that are open to hunting, and on each of those divisions, I know on the Upper Wells division, we have at least four blinds that are, in a sense, grandfathered. And they can be maintained and used. They don't have to be removed. All new blinds are temporary blinds, and we require them to be removed. This is where we hold sole interest in the property. If blinds, I used to waterfowl hunt myself. I don't anymore. But if those blinds are put up ahead of the season, they don't necessarily need to be there all the season, because you are hunting a migratory bird that's moving through. If those blinds are put up and removed the whole time they're there, is not during the growing season, then I can accomplish what I would like to see accomplished, and the hunter could still engage in their activity with little or no impact on their particular interest.
Number eight. It speaks of motor vehicles, use of motor vehicles, including boats powered by motors and aircraft in place of emergency. Now, what you're prohibiting is if at the high tide, if somebody comes up through there in a motorboat, that's illegal?
No. That's legal.
That's going to be legal, right?
Legal.
Okay. How about all-terrain vehicles, them four-wheelers and whatever? How are we going to control those?
Well, it says here that they are, it says use of motor vehicles and aircraft. It's saying that they're, you can't use them on the property. If you permit ATVs to ride around out there, four-wheel drive, it causes a real mess, and it takes many, many years
I understand the problem. You have to go into that. But do you feel motor vehicle covers ATVs? That's my question.
Oh, yeah, motor vehicle. It's a vehicle driven by a motor. Oh, I misunderstood your question. Yes, it does cover ATVs.
Okay. I think that's all I have.
Andy, I have a couple of questions. I remember our past conversations, and the point came up that the marsh has never been managed, and some of us, or maybe all of us, feel that it should have been and should be. But I think I note a little concern among the council members about the degree of control that the town is going to have over your management activities. What if you propose to do something about the duck blinds that really caused an uproar in the town? Would we, as representatives, have any control over your actions, any negotiation powers with your folks?
As far as duck blinds,
I don't want to go into those specifically.
No, I know.
I think we have already.
It's hard to talk in general because you're looking for a specific answer to a general question, and it's very difficult for me to respond to that. Primarily, we're going to manage that area. The whole reason we were trying to enter into this agreement was to manage the area in its natural condition, basically for the benefit of the Fish and Wildlife resource, and that's how we're going to manage it. And as I went over before, a number of the different management proposals or activities I may engage in, and if something like that did cause a problem, that is something that would be worked out.
You're saying basically then that the town has not relinquished all control.
No. Over that resource? No, not.
You are not saying that. Seems to me that we should have a provision that spells out the procedure by which we would come to an agreement once a disagreement had occurred. There should be some sort of procedure.
Arbitrary.
The town ought to be notified as to what your proposals are, what you plan to do.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there's any... there's no mention of that, is there?
Well, in number nine, it talks about it. I think something could be included in that paragraph to state that we will notify you. It says we'll notify you of construction and excavation and things like that. But maybe we could
We should be notified of your plan.
That's what I mean.
Your management
right.
plan. And we also should give some consideration to a process. If for some reason there's disagreement between your folks and us, seems to me there ought to be a process for sitting down and working through that.
Yeah, you could.
The Conservation Commission being your arbitrator, the Communities Conservation Commission?
Well, ultimately, though, it's the council that is the decision-making. Certainly, you could work through them first, but I would think that ultimately it should be the council that agrees or disagrees. I would think that you would have to work very closely with the Conservation Commission and with the council. As you plan your management. Now, I think that we would like to know what your plans are in advance.
Well, as I said earlier, we would be notifying you of our plans in advance. The only thing that I guess isn't addressed in here is what would happen in the event that there is a stalemate
mm-hmm.
on a particular
okay.
project.
Okay, I hope that Michael will work with you to make sure that some process is spelled out. And the other thing that concerns me is I see no mention of management of the resource for the general public's enjoyment, recreational enjoyment, and education. The marsh ought to be a place where school kids can go and learn about the various forms of vegetation and the biology of a marsh. And in conjunction with that, I just want to mention something that I brought up before, and that is, I think you should be thinking about a nature trail along the edge of the marsh. Because it's been brought up before, the general public does not really have access to that marsh. And there should be a controlled access, it seems to me. Maybe that isn't important to other councilors, but I would like to see a provision in this agreement for that.
In number three, it talks about buildings and structures, and it says, except as needed to provide access for the public. There is the, in number three, there is the possibility of putting in a nature trail or an interpretive nature trail, and that's at the discretion of really the community or the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service or both together.
Yeah.
As far as having access to the property, us picking up that property is not going to change access at all because we're picking it up. It's going to be in public ownership, and you can access that property along any of our boundaries, provided you're not trespassing on.
What I'm saying is, for the general public, there is not an organized access to the marsh, and there is no mention of recreational enjoyment and education, which I think is very important in managing these natural resources. I personally would like to see a provision.
Yeah, I agree that is very important to Fish and Wildlife Management. We do have an area on the Upper Wells Division that's designated for high public use, and we provide, we have an interpretive trail that's wheelchair accessible. It's a little over a mile long. Some of the other divisions, we concentrate more on fish and wildlife management because we are that's the type of agency that we are. And in previous meetings before the council, I did state that if there is an interest in the community to provide some type of formal access, that I would be more than happy to cooperate with the community and develop something.
I'm saying is I would like to see this in the agreement so that it could be a goal perhaps for the future. And I think Michael is willing to work with you. He's got a list here of several of the comments that have been made. And we're not being critical of the agreement. It's just that we would like to see some additional language. Michael.
Just, there may still be more council concerns to come forward, but maybe to summarize at this point of what I understand you would like to see. First is more information on the appraisal. How was the amount arrived at? Are there comparable amounts? Secondly, better provision on permitting duck blinds in paragraph 3. Issue on what limits perhaps there should or should not be. To look into reporting mechanisms both pre-reporting and post-reporting. What I mean by that is a notification of a plan beforehand, what is going to be done, and then a follow-up report of what, in fact, has been done. To look at what if there are disagreements, should there be a process for arbitration, who should be the arbitrator. To look into a reversionary clause, if we come to the feeling that they just aren't managing it the way that the town feels the agreement provided for, that there would be a provision. And the issue of public education, recreation, nature trail, to permit that to take place. That's what I have so far.
Jane.
I'd like to consider one other item, and that would be having an appraisal done by another party, someone that the town would hire. Given all of the restrictions that we want put on the land, I'd like to see another independent appraisal done.
Councilor Torrey.
Just from a professional's point of view, as you've managed other properties throughout the state and elsewhere in your career, is there any problem with the coexisting? I'm just trying to think in my mind of the problem of the coexisting with the educational nature, recreational side that Councilor Mastin just emphasized, and also the right of the hunters and the hunting. You know, and what I'm wondering is if you allow plentiful and bountiful hunting in an area that has also been, you know, the citizens of Cape have been told to go down there and utilize it for walking trails, etc. Is this coexistence happening elsewhere? Is it present a hazard to the public? I can see if both sides of those really started taking off, you could have some problems certain times of the year.
We refer to that as user conflict. Yes,
that's
we do.
What I was like. I knew there was a good term for that.
Well, we had to a couple of years ago, or actually it was at a previous station, perform an evaluation, try and identify user conflicts, and yes, it does. If you have a hunting zone in the same area you identify as a public use zone, you're creating a user conflict, which carries a certain liability with that. I had to address one at this refuge when I came here, and that is a potential. In other words, you're saying come here and hunt, and you're saying come here and take a nature walk, and you can't have a conflict. If you designate certain areas as hunting, provide a certain safety zone, you can provide access for the public in the form of a nature trail or even so much as a kiosk or an information board. There's different ways of handling. There's a lot of interest in this particular parcel, and we have another half dozen items that we need to crank into the conservation easement, and it starts to make it difficult to juggle them.
I think it's critical as we start to define these areas, as you call them, user conflict, that the board, the council here, be involved in, because that's really some policy decisions that could be having to be made, or at least that you could run the idea by us in terms of here's what I see as the safety zone, here is the recreational zone, here is the hunting zone. I'd like to be fully appraised and participate in that. I don't want to relinquish that right in terms of how much is the hunting zone versus the recreation and how good is that buffer zone, because I am very concerned of people's safety if we encourage them to go use it recreationally. You know, I don't want to be sitting in a very awkward position where someone was injured or killed down there. So I hope that part is not relinquished by the council as you continue to appraise the manager, who will then appraise us of developments down there.
That's not relinquished by the community, because I think it's at the beginning of the actual language and easement that we will go along with state and federal regulations, or maybe close as a public safety or public hazard, or as you will. So we recognize that, and you know, as you brought this up, I could see the same potential that you're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be, if we resolve all these things, it would be the responsibility of the manager, whoever they may be, to identify the zones, but that's later.
Yeah.
You can't really address that here.
No. I know how seeds, when you plant them in fertile soil, will grow up and become big
and
trees.
Sometimes
and I don't want this to grow and become a problem while we're just at the planting of a seed stage.
Yeah, that's why we try to initially address the idea of if there is some sort of a hazard or a public unsafe, we will relinquish that right to the town. We will adhere to any state and federal regulations, just like the town has to adhere to state and federal regulations. I know it's like a cover all, but we all have to adhere to that. But we did try to recognize that in our conversations with Mike. I would like to just address your comment about the appraisal. We have no objection. I mean, seriously, if you want to have an appraisal done, fine. I would say that an appraisal done to federal standards is different than an appraisal done out on the outside. We have very strict rules that we have to adhere to when we do an appraisal. I can tell you, I'm more than happy to give you a list of appraisals. I can't do this personally. I don't have the list with me. of people that know how to prepare an appraisal for federal standards. If you don't want to do that, hire somebody. I can tell you right now, the chances are they're going to call us for comparable sales, because we're the ones that buy marsh. I just want to be open and honest with you about that, because we get calls from appraisers all the time. What are you paying for marshland? I've answered at least three or four that I can think of about what do you pay for a conservation easement. Okay, he's right. I answered his home phone today. Somebody called about comparables for marshland. So the appraisers know that we're the ones that are buying it, either us or the state, and in this area, we are the market. But I'm not saying don't. I'm just saying that's the reality. Okay.
Well, in the interest of moving this along, Michael, pending your further discussions on these items that have been brought up by members of the council, we should hold on posting for public hearing, I would think.
I would think you would want to table this until you had a report on further negotiations.
Do I hear a motion, Bill?
I'll make that a motion, and I would, if I'm able,
no.
Madam Chairman, I would like to ask you're not going to let me do it. And
you can ask
a
point.
I'll table it after I make my comment.
Okay.
That's good.
I'm in very much in agreement that what Councilor Torrey just brought up about if we're going to have a recreational area down there, that it will be separated and well signed and everything, or it's either going to be a hunting area, one or the other. I don't think, maybe you can have both, but you people know more about it than I do, but I think it's pretty hard to have both. It's quite a few school children go down there in the springtime and they walk out through there and what have you, and I don't think you prohibit that, do you, regardless? So if we're going to put trails and what have you in there, I just hope that we get it separated properly so nobody will get hurt, like he says. So I'll move it, we table till a later date.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any? All those in favor?
Anyway, you almost made a mistake.
Okay, it's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, and we will be having further discussions.
I've got your number.
I'm sure.
Item number 81, to consider granting a drainage easement to Pond Cove Associates and take any necessary action. Michael?
Pond Cove Associates approached the planning board about 5 or 6 months ago to subdivide the land next to the town hall in back of us. Specifically, it extends the land that the gas station is on, the bank, the doctor's office, the apartment house, the storage building out back. As one of the conditions of the subdivision approval, the planning board required Pond Cove Associates to obtain a drainage easement from the town for water that comes over into the catch basin on the town hall property. Traditionally, there's been a kind of a loose relationship between the property owners next door and the town hall property. We discovered a few years ago, for instance, that one of our buildings was in fact on their property. The property owner that was involved in that one, who was a member of the associates, although it wasn't specifically associates property, very graciously granted us an easement, granted us a transfer of property to make sure that our building was in fact on our lot. This is simply, I think a good legal practice in that if you do have drainage extending from one property to another, that there be an agreement between the two parties in the form of an easement. So I would recommend that you grant this 20-foot drainage easement to Pond Cove Associates and authorize me to sign the document executing the easement.
Councilor Lester Jordan.
If somebody had been doing this for 100 years and never been stopped, don't they have the right to do it anyway, period?
perhaps this just makes it so that we don't get into a contest in later years. It just cleans up the fact that's been around for a long time.
I'll move that we have the town manager enter into an agreement, give them the easement, 20-foot easement.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Item number 82, to consider approving a dedication of land in accordance with section 16-3-10 in the pending Runaway Farm subdivision to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and take any necessary action. Michael?
You have before you a map that shows the lot in question. It's located over in the vicinity, not too far from the Spurling Church, specifically across the street, sort of behind the old Layton property. There's a gravel pit in the area. I think you're all familiar with it. Again, this was a subdivision that has been going through the planning board. The developer is a gentleman by the name of Lawrence Eubank, who is here this evening. Nat Clifford of the Land Trust is also here this evening. The subdivision regulations of the town require that any dedication of land as a result of a subdivision go to the town council for approval, regardless of whether or not the dedication go to the town itself or to a group such as the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. This has been extensively reviewed by the planning board, and they do recommend that you authorize the exact wording according to the ordinance regulations is that you approve the dedication.
Nat Clifford is here tonight. Did you have anything you wanted to contribute to that explanation, Nat?
As I'm sure you're all aware, the conditions of approval by the planning board were that the area designated as lot number 5 on the development plan or the subdivision plan is deeded to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and in turn that the town receive an easement from the land trust, which I believe is before you now. The ordinance requires that the town manager and town attorney approve the easement, which again has been submitted for that approval. Key to the easement are the words that appear in the first page. Again, this is the easement from the land trust, assuming our taking title to the property. The words that the property is to remain in a substantially undeveloped, open, and natural state. Paraphrasing again, it is the purpose of the grantor, being the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and the holder, the town of Cape Elizabeth, to assure the protection and conservation of the property. And again, paraphrasing further down, the grantor and the holder have the common purpose of conserving the natural values of the property. All of this implies the use that the property is to be put to, and also the cooperative relationship that we hope exists and will continue to between the town and the land trust.
Any questions of Nat? Councilor Jordan?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. I just don't understand why we grant an easement, conservation easement, to the land trust, where I take it the town has its own conservation commission, and I thought that that's the purpose of the conservation commission was to have land turned over to the town of Cape Elizabeth and not to another entity for conservation purposes. Now, if somebody wants to come along and give the land to the land trust, that's okay. that's separate altogether, in my opinion. But when they give it to the, they want to give it to the conservation, I mean, the land trust, and get credit for the ordinance about dedicating so much open space, and then ask the town to transfer it over, I don't quite understand, and I don't think that we should do that. I think that land, if it's going to be a conservation easement, and to fit the ordinance, should stay within the town of Cape Elizabeth, and the town of Cape Elizabeth only, as far as title and changes. So I am opposed to this item as far as changing, transferring it to land trust. I think if it's a conservation easement, it should stay within the town.
If I may respond through the chair.
Yes.
Mr. Jordan alluded to the town giving up an easement or giving up something. You further indicated that you have no objection to the land trust receiving deeds or easements. In this case, to clarify the situation, the land trust has or will be deeded the property without restriction. And to conform to the language in the easement, which we believe is a proper use and restriction to place on land, we would like to have somebody hold an easement over and above any language in any town ordinances, which I don't believe is appropriate for me to comment on. We are therefore giving to the town an easement. The town is giving up nothing in this case. And were the process to stop with our receipt of a deed for the property, in other words, ownership and fee simple for the 19 acres, we in turn, I think, the land trust, would aggressively seek a recipient for the easement to assure us that the property would be maintained in the manner that we want it to be. We can't give ourselves that easement. And the deed, for various reasons, cannot be restricted. It has to be a free and clear transfer of the property without restriction. So as the property comes to the land trust without restriction, the next question is, how can we be assured that that property will be covered by these types of restrictions? So that really this is, in one sense, outside the process that's indicated within the new section of the town subdivision regulation. Now, the fact that the town is being given the easement has satisfied the planning board in administering the regulation or the subdivision ordinance that requires the 10% donation.
Doug?
Go ahead. I had a question, but go ahead.
Go ahead. You have the floor.
Well, I understand what you're saying as far as it's already been deeded to the land trust, and then you come to the town for a conservation easement. Why, if there's going to have a conservation easement there, why doesn't the Conservation Commission recommend to the town council, which is part of a committee of the town, for accepting that as a conservation easement in the name of the town of Cape Elizabeth?
The chairman
can do that. They can do that within the ordinance, by giving, the developer can do that within the ordinance, can he?
The developer has no further rights on the property once he is extended or given the deed to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. His role at that point is over with. He has no further right or interest in the 19 acres.
Well, then he didn't know what was going to happen when he went to you people and give the land to the land trust then. Then he realized afterwards that he had to have the conservation easement, that for you people to have a conservation easement, then you had to come back to the town. I just don't quite understand why we got to go through this.
Michael.
Perhaps I could answer it rather directly. By the property owner deeding it to the land trust free and clear, any property owner in a situation like this receives a full credit on their federal taxes for a contribution. Once you, based on a full value, once you begin to put, much as the discussion we just had with Rachel Carson, once you begin to put all sorts of restrictions on it, it reduces the value of the land for tax purposes for the original owner. One advantage in this instance of having the land trust and having a middleman involved is that there's more of an incentive to donate land because someone can get the full tax benefit from it. And, you know, I think that's in some respects, you know, why this arrangement is before you in this manner tonight, and perhaps why other similar arrangements will be before you in the future.
If I
may, tax purposes,
just respond to that. This is a part I don't agree with. The town of Cape Elizabeth is losing the land, and it will then belong to another group, and I don't think that is what we should be doing. And if there's something in the tax law that gives them a benefit to give it to the land trust, all the land in the future will be going to land trust instead of to the town. If it's going off the rolls of the taxpayers of the town of Cape Elizabeth and then doesn't stay within the town and then goes to somebody else, somebody should be paying the taxes on it.
I was speaking of federal taxes, income taxes, and it's the deductibility of the contribution.
Councilor Jordan?
Yeah, I've been in agreement of what the land trust is trying to do and acquire land and so forth, but with this particular instance where we've just passed a new ordinance that a developer has to either give 10% of his land or money, I think this is a precedent setting. I don't see that they should be giving it to a private entity. They should be giving it to the town of Cape Elizabeth. So that's where I agree with Billy, perhaps. And I'd like to get in on it, really. I wish somebody would give me the land. And then I could just say I was gonna farm it or something. I don't think it's right that a developer can give it to that 10% to anybody he wants to. That's my hang up on it. I have.
Councilor Tinsman.
I just had a couple of quick questions and then I'd like a little longer answer on another question. But basically this is to meet the provisions of a new subdivision ordinance requiring the 10% donation or whatever for open passive recreation as part of the development. Is that what you're trying to say?
No, my position, Mr. Tinsman, is that the land trust would like to be assured that this land will be protected in an open state forever. In order to do that, the land needs to be encumbered either through deed restrictions or through an easement such as this. Now, for the reasons that the manager alluded to, the owner, the current owner of this property, elected to donate the land free and clear to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust in good faith that we would assure that the land was tied up in perpetuity. The only way we can do that, since we can't give ourselves an easement, is to extend the easement or find another recipient for it, the town being a very logical recipient. That is one chain of events. It also so happens, and a chain of events that the land trust is not involved in, that the planning board elected to have that extension of an easement or the giving of an easement to the town satisfy the 10% requirement, exactly conforming to the language in the subdivision regulation.
Okay, what is the nature of this land? Is it flat, hilly?
It runs wet? From a marshy area down towards a brook that flows into the Spurwink Marsh back to some upland areas. The appraisal indicates that it was considered as a single house lot, which I fully believe it would have qualified as. So what it is basically is a 19-acre swamp on one end, highland on the other, house lot.
And I guess my last question, where does a land trust involve itself with the planning board process? In other words, do you negotiate, just because I'm unfamiliar with your process, do you negotiate with the landowner prior to the planning board review on the process? Do you insert yourself within the review? Are you asked to by the planning board? Or is this an option the planning board says, well, we can go to the Conservation Commission, or let's go to the land trust with this one? How do you involve yourself, and how did it happen to come down this way?
In this
other than the tax reasons, which I think could have been applied to the Conservation Commission.
And yes, it could be. And then, in fact, as has happened in the past, the easements would flow in the opposite direction. Town would own, land trust would hold an easement. Either entity holding a parcel of property free and clear can do anything with it. And if, in fact, it's generally agreed by whoever that the property should be maintained in perpetuity in a forever wild state, then one should own and the other should hold the easement. And it really, as far as I can tell, and I think most of my directors would agree with me, it doesn't make any difference which way the ownership and the easements flow. How we become involved with the planning board, and you use words like negotiation, I don't believe we should be. And I believe the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust is a private, nonprofit entity dedicated to preserving open space in Cape Elizabeth. In this case, we should be characterized as a recipient for a piece of property that an owner wanted to see dedicated forever wild. And we followed the trust placed on us by the owner in extending this easement to the town. Our charter and the activities of other land trusts that are older than ours, which is only a couple of years old, and we're really feeling our way into some of these ways of preserving land. But our charter will allow us to become more aggressive and to perhaps in the future form coalitions with developers in order to preserve open space on the basis that half a loaf is better than none. At the moment, we are not advocating any development project in the town, and again should be characterized as recipients. If it should come to pass that the land trust should become involved in a development project, again because the parcel of land might be too rich for us to take on by ourselves, it'll be patently clear to the planning board and the town exactly what our role is. And in this case, again, I want to emphasize that we are simply a recipient that was contacted by a developer, or by a property owner, actually, to take on this 19 acres and guarantee him that it would be kept in a forever wild state. And there was some faith needed, and I think the flexibility of a private entity such as the Land Trust and our ability to commit, again, we have the same constituency as the town, but I think we're able to function in a more streamlined fashion. We don't have the burdens, obviously, that town government does, and a single purpose. And this, I think, is an example of a property owner feeling this was the right way to go to assure that the land would be placed in a forever wild state.
Councillor Carson, welcome aboard.
Thank you. I guess I want to say we've had some discussions about the relationship between the Land Trust, Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and the town of Cape Elizabeth. But it seems in this particular issue, item, and correct me if I'm wrong, that the ordinance that we set where it requires 10%, ask for 10% of the land or dollars to be given, to dedicate it over to the town of Cape Elizabeth or any other approved entity. Isn't there some words in our ordinance that there isn't any?
It says, such a entity as the land trust.
Okay. Or such as an entity of the land trust. So in this particular item, doesn't this meet actually the exact wording of the ordinance as we approved it? Even though we may have some other issues with the land trust in understanding the position of the two things, the town and the land trust, this particular item meets the letter of the ordinance as we approved it, does it not?
That's section.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I just follow up on that in a second?
Yes.
Just for clarification purposes, it seems to me here that the developer, correct me if I'm wrong, but the developer kind of approached the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and said, here's something that I'd like to work out, and then together went to the planning board, rather than the planning board recommended this to the developer, saying you're going to have to give up this bunch of land, and we recommend that you give it to the land trust. Because I think the essence of the questions is why would one town, one board of the town, i.e. the Planning Board or the Conservation Commission, recommend it be given to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust rather than the town? That doesn't seem to make sense that it should do that rather than give it to the town if there's no tax advantages to giving it to the land trust. But in this case, it seems that outside of the Planning Board process, is that correct, what happened?
That is correct. And
so I think that helps alleviate some of the fears possible.
Never, for the record, in any of my conversations with the owner of the property, did the subject of the 10% requirement come up.
Right.
The owner simply wanted to make a donation of the 19 acres. And it later came in through activity with the Planning Board between the owner and the Planning Board.
We may worry about that down the road, but that's not pertinent to this particular example.
Councilor Jordan.
Sorry to answer Councilor Carson's dilemma over there. That's where I disagreed on passage of that ordinance, and where it said that you could give it to the land trust. Even though I dearly love the land trust and what they're doing, I just don't think it's right that you can satisfy this ordinance by giving it to a private entity. I think if they can give it to the land trust, he ought to be able to give it to me. Maybe he wouldn't want to because I couldn't give him a tax break, but maybe I could say I was going to build a church on the thing or something like that. Maybe he could get a tax break then. And I think it should be given. If you're going to satisfy the ordinance requirement that ordinance that was passed, I think it should be given to the town of Cape Elizabeth rather than a private entity.
We would need to correct that, though.
Yes.
Nat, how does the public gain access to this property, which looks to be kind of landlocked? Is it this little strip here, the public waiver?
Yes, that's a 10-foot strip that runs from Spurwink Avenue into the 19-acre parcel. And that also will be deeded to the land trust, so it's part of the 19 acres.
It is?
Yes. The reason for holding to a 10-foot width is to prevent parking in that area that, again, the...
It will be a trail. It won't be
that's
a, road,
correct.
A dirt road.
That's correct.
Councilor Amaro?
Mr. Clifford, what happens to any property that the land trust accumulates over the years if the land trust at some point is dissolved?
Our charter, and it's typical of most organizations, land trusts in the state and other conservation organizations, our charter requires that all our holdings, easements, and ownership and fee simple be transferred to a similar organization. And that could be another land trust, even though it may be another town. It could be the Nature Conservancy. It could be the Maine Coast Heritage Trust. There are plenty of organizations around that would take on the ownerships and easements.
In your charter, do you have the ability to sell off parcels of this land in order to purchase another piece of land that you might find more desirable at some point?
Yes, we do, and that is one of the reasons that land trusts are able to function effectively, but also one of the reasons that we wanted to place an easement on this property to uphold our agreement with the owner. In other words, restrictions could not be put in the deed, but the owner wanted to see the property preserved. And the most effective way to do it is to place easements on the property, because I can't guarantee that some future board of directors years down the road might not sell the property. And in fact, that might possibly be the concern that potential donors would have in deeding property to the town. Again, we have a single purpose. The town has many considerations.
But the town could also put the same sort of requirement.
That's correct.
On any piece of land that was donated.
That's right.
And that, in fact, has happened with the Stonegate dedication of land to the town, is that we did put very stringent restrictions on that piece of property.
Oh, Frank.
Just to follow up on that, could it have been in the charter that the land would revert back to the town if upon the dissolution of the, the unfortunate dissolution of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust? I know that may be floating through seven people's minds that are up here right now.
Yeah. If the land trust is negotiating in good faith, either for donation or purchase of properties or easements on the basis that those properties are to be maintained in a forever wild state and with various types of restrictions on them. The town, again, is an organization not dedicated to the preservation of open space. There are many, many considerations, budgetary constraints. And in order to maintain the same type of ownership, the properties would have to revert to a similar organization. And this is very standard in any conservation organization's charter. And this comes up almost 100% of the time when we're talking with property owners about either purchasing or they're donating property to us, the question of what happens if we do go out of business. And the answer being the property would revert to a similar organization satisfies that that question.
Penny?
Do most people who give land to the land trust put the same restrictions on it that it shall forever remain as open space? Because if they do not put those restrictions on, then those are the pieces that the land trust could sell. But if an owner always puts the restrictions on that he wants it to remain as an open space or it should be used as recreation or whatever he stipulates, then you can't sell it. Or even when you give it to somebody else, that restriction will pass on. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Well, you know, I mean, to be honest with you, I think that our discussions have been that I would say to myself, I would prefer to have this town, if this organization should dissolve, I would prefer to have this land revert to the town with those same stipulations that it remain as open space than to some other creative entity. And I would hope that if the restrictions were written in there, the easements, that we would also, you'd have to respect those. Mm. But to have these pieces of land be floating around with the possible dissolution of a variety of organizations with no control of the town of Cape Elizabeth means that without restrictions by the owner, they could be bought and sold and bought and sold and bought and sold. So that the owner's original intent, if not made clear, his original intent, he may think he's giving it to the town of Cape Elizabeth to remain ever open. But if he doesn't stipulate that, then that land is up for grab 10 years from now to be traded as for another piece. So we are very concerned that the owner understand absolutely completely that he's giving it to the land trust and that is not the same as giving it to the town of Cape Elizabeth. And that if he puts no restrictions on it, then the land trust can do a variety of things with it in the future, a couple of decades, let's say. So I would have to, I don't know how the land trust works, but I would certainly hope that he knows those things. First of all, he's given to the land trust, not to the town of Cape Elizabeth, and that you do have the right to sell or trade or swap or something down the road. And if he wants it to remain forever open, then he needs to go through an easement process such as this.
Or needs to agree that an easement will be placed on the land, but it cannot be documented in the transfer if a full tax deduction is to be maintained. Again, that's a matter of faith that the donor has to hold his breath for just that second that the land transfers to the land trust and then the easement transfers to the town in this case.
But how about the other cases? You might be holding land now that you could sell 5 years from now, but that was not really the intent of the owner when he gave it to you.
Thinking very quickly about the ownerships that we have, the owner's wishes are covered in one way or another. And again, the flexibility that the land trust has, I believe also as a fledgling organization, it'd be suicide for us to leave even doubt in an owner's land or in his mind as to what would happen to the land. For the record, and this is a little bit off the record, I have sensed and we've had discussions with various segments of the council. I see a greater communality of interest than I believe all of you maybe in certain senses are expressing. And I would welcome a workshop session. I would suggest that I should bring others from my board of directors that so you can have the basis of a consensus rather than just one fool's opinion. But I think it would be extremely productive because I many of the concerns you have I know are covered. And we could go through our ownerships and through some of our goals and things that we hope to accomplish in town. And I think what you say about how do we treat land given us? I think there are parcels of land that the town owns that we and other citizens might be concerned about, and I think there may be a process of easementing some of those to protect both ways. And the town, I think, has to maintain free ownership of certain parcels of land, the land the town hall sits on, obviously. But I think, again, there's that communality of interest that a workshop would be tremendously productive, and I'd welcome it.
We do intend to do that, and actually I think we should bring the subject of this discussion back to the item on the agenda. But these were questions that we were sort of getting into that we had asked at other workshop sessions, and we sure do want a workshop because we don't understand exactly how it works. But I'd like to bring it back if I can to the item on the agenda.
Councilor Jordan?
I just want to say that I had understood from a member of Land Trust, but I guess I didn't put the question to him right, that if Land Trust went defunct, that it would revert to the town of Cape Elizabeth, all the holdings. Now I understand you could transfer your land to Maine Coastal, any of these, you might say, Land Trust type entities, maybe up from North Overshoe, as far as we're concerned, if you want. I'll admit, what you people are doing, I'm sitting here thinking of what might happen in years to come. You might not be there because you're one of the originals' intent. Other people get different ideas as time goes on. And this is a part that disturbs me. Mm-hmm. It disturbs me very deeply that we're losing this land by not being in the town of Cape Elizabeth. And even though as long as you're here and your group is available, other people might think different 10, 15 years from now. And I would hope that, and I've mentioned to you before about a workshop, and I'd hope that we could have one fairly soon, because I am going to recommend that, even though I'm a member of it, the Ordinance Committee take a hard look at that portion of the ordinance. And I think the Land Trust deal should be stricken from it. And I would propose that at a later date.
Now, I just have two quick questions. Did you work with the Conservation Commission?
Yes, the chairman of the Conservation Commission reviewed this easement before it went to the town, and his comments are incorporated in here.
Okay. Does this have any relation to the proposed green belt plan? Is it anywhere near? I know it's near the Spurwink Marsh.
Mm.
Is it?
It does not.
It's not near related to Great Pond.
No. No.
It's sort of off on its own.
For the moment, it is, yes.
It could be a partial leg. Getting out from the old Cooper property to Fowler Road to Sprague's.
We're not far from the access of the greenbelt that would go through the area in back of the town transfer station. And,
you mean Gullcrest?
Yeah. That's right.
It's not far.
That's correct.
It's possible that they could be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Councilor Tinsman.
Just one question when it comes to retaining rights of the land trust as opposed to the easement restrictions on the town. I notice that you're retaining a lot of rights as the deed owner, title holder. And those rights could be interpreted, in my mind, to be public rights or public needs at some point in time. And for instance, if we needed an easement for sewerage, water, electrical, or whatever, in behalf of the town, you retain those rights. How do we work with the land trust in obtaining further rights in this land that you have? For instance, the landowners on Fowler Road develop some real problems and need additional land for sewage or for their septic systems. That's specifically excluded in our agreement. We cannot allow that to happen. Well, you've not allowed us to let that happen on this land. Now, he gave it with no restrictions, and now you're putting restrictions as part of your conservation easement. How do we work those out later?
I'm not an attorney, but my interpretation of this would be that land trust would be no different than any other property owner. We have extended the town an easement, giving the town certain rights to that land. One of those rights is not running a sewer across the land. However, the easement does not preclude the sale or an additional easement to permit that sewer to go across the land. There is no lessening of that capability. It simply is not part of this bunch of rights that we're extending to the town.
So you could, in fact, transfer the land, the ownership interest in the land behind those homes, to the individual homeowner subject to our conservation easement, if you needed some cash?
I don't see that the easement would have any effect. I think you would go back to a parcel of land that is owned by the land trust. The town has certain rights. Placing a sewer there is not one of those rights. Therefore, you'd have to go through the process of a new easement or purchasing a land in fee simple or taking it by eminent domain.
Okay, but as far as the landowners go, and this is just a wild scenario that may not happen, but those landowners on Fowler Road could purchase the land from the land trust subject to the conservation easement that the town has. And in essence, they would be retaining the rights that you have or proposed to have. You could sell pieces of this land to a third party. Those third parties
with the easement.
Sure, subject to the conservation easement.
Right.
That would be the process to go through.
Well, we've talked earlier about the land trust going out of business, and if the ownership should transfer to another entity, the condition would still be the same. In other words, you would be dealing with a different entity, but again, probably eminent domain would be the ultimate if negotiations couldn't achieve a right-of-way.
The only reason I even brought this up was that there's a mechanism where private ownership can be obtained from the town if necessary. I mean, if there's a need for subsurface septic systems, it can be done through the town, because we sit up here and we could allow that to happen. Where the land trust owns it, we've removed ourselves from that negotiating posture.
It's not the intent, that's correct. It's not the intent of this easement to transfer that right to the town.
I don't know whether that makes the council feel uncomfortable or not, but.
Councilor Carson.
I think I'd like to move this question, and I think that I would also encourage, I'm not going to make it a motion, but that we get into a workshop so that we all understand the position of the town and the land trust. I'd like to move the question of item number 82, and approve the dedication of land in accordance with section 16-3-10 and in the pending Runaway Farm subdivision to the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Councilor Amaral?
Yeah, I'm really very uncomfortable about this whole procedure, and I would agree with Councilor William Jordan that I'd like to take another look at section 16-3-10 also, because I really have the feeling that if the town has no real control over this land that's being dedicated, that we ought to reconsider what we did in establishing that ordinance, because our intent, I feel, was to provide for the town open space areas for recreation that the town did in fact have control over. So I'm going to vote for this tonight because it does comply with our ordinances, but I feel very uncomfortable doing so.
We ready for a vote? Councilor LaTorre?
I would just like to say I understand Councilor Amaral's concern, but I do need to put in a certain plug, I guess, for the word that Nat used earlier, which is faith. And we certainly have worked with the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. We've seen it grow and evolve, and there has to be some type of rapport between the town and this land trust in order to make this thing work. And the only other rapport that I'm really familiar with is in the town of Freeport, where the land trust and the municipal land bank, people are working together and making it work. And I don't want to come across as at all pessimistic towards it. I'm very optimistic towards this organization, and there are certain leaps of faith that are going to have to be met, which we can work out in workshops, et cetera. But I don't have any rethinking in my own mind whatsoever of that ordinance. I knew exactly what I was voting for when I drafted it and voted for it. You know, I was voting for the faith that I have in the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to accomplish that we have one set of goals that we're working on together. And they can provide certain tax advantages that we as a municipality can't. But as far as I'm concerned, our goals towards providing open space are totally harmonious and one. So I wanted to just state that from my opinion on this whole situation.
Councilor Jordan?
Just one little comment that Nat made that kind of disturbed me, that he didn't feel the council was very, I forget just the word you used there, as far as obtaining land for open space due to budget restraints and what have you. I'll admit we haven't put any bucks into it, but I think the town of Cape Elizabeth has picked up quite a little land through agreements with developers in the last few years, and I think we've made a big step forward. And I think the problem that bothers me here, that you can take your land and do what you want to, but we have to answer to the taxpayers. And I'm sure if we went to sell a parcel of it, there'd be some taxpayers here, and it might end up in something like a referendum or something like that. So I think we are working in that direction.
I just want to say, Michael, before you have your two cents worth, that I feel that the town and the land trust are working toward the same goal, and that is the preservation of open space and public enjoyment of that. And I would welcome a workshop to learn more about your organization. I would welcome trying to get you to rethink the ability of land reverting to the town. But I do not have any problems with voting for this, for approving at this time.
I just had a question for Mrs. Carson clarifying the motion. You asked that the dedication of land be approved. I didn't hear the portion of accepting the easement. Just was asking if you intended to include that in the motion.
Yes.
And we had a second.
Yes.
Are you ready for the vote? All those in favor? 1, 2, 3, 4. Opposed? 4-3. At this juncture, we'll take a 5-minute break.